addressed it. And open yourself with me for a full experience of that love, which includes loving yourself. So as I say these words, I'll say a few and give you time to consider how that love is and is in and permeates you. May I be filled with loving kindness. May all be well. May I be peaceful and at ease. May I be happy. Feeling the fullness of that love, of that consciousness of life. Let us begin to come back to this time and this place, filled with that great love. And turn it outward. May you be filled with loving kindness. May all be well. May you be peaceful and at ease. May you be happy. Betty mentioned Buddhist understanding and study. That little four-line affirmation, it really is an affirmation. Is one that has always stuck with me. I wanted to share it with you this morning. So Charlie's title was about harmonizing, and I thought it was just wonderfully appropriate, because Betty did not know this, that I took that theme, the theme of self-love, and talked about, and chose a new title, Stepping into Love. And you talked about taking those steps that guidance gave you, were right on. Reverend Charlie didn't want to brave the ice to come over the mountain, and I think that's prudent. And so so a couple days ago when we talked, she shared with me where she was going, and it kind of took me in a slightly different path, but using the same theme of self-love. So our title is Stepping Into Self-Love. As soon as you know what the name of this story is, I'd like you to speak it out. I'm going to share a little story, which I'm sure probably everyone has heard before. There was a wealthy father who had two sons.
Prodigal son.
Oh, he didn't. And his home was full of life and joy and comfort that the sons enjoyed. But the younger son really wanted to know and explore the world, very curious fellow, one day said, "Father, will you give me my inheritance because I'd like to go down my own?" And the father did. And the son took the inheritance and went to a far country. In that far country, it is told that he engaged in riotous living. He took that curiosity to the limit. Until there was a famine in the land, and he was reduced, having spent all his inheritance, to feeding pigs. And then at one point, he came to himself. It says, "Even the servants back in my father's house have food and a warm place to sleep." And he changed direction and looked back to his father's house and was welcomed. His father saw him coming far off and welcomed him without a shred of judgment with open arms. That's a story, but I'd like to give it just a little bit of a metaphysical twist this morning. And we'll take some of the key points in that story and relate them to an inner meaning, something that we don't see in the words, but that we see in the truth of the story. First of all, the father's house, very poignant image, could be referred to as the kingdom of heaven. Omnipresence has been spoken about, but I'd like to speak about it this morning as the center of our being. The touch point that says, "I am the Father, I am the Divine, I am everyone, are one." I call that living consciously. So, the Father's house, living consciously. The younger son, had a few things to learn in life, had some catching up to do. Certainly hadn't even approached wisdom. So that younger son it was that went out in his curious way to explore life. That younger son represents that in us that has some catching up to do, that needs some growth, that's looking for wisdom that is yet in the future. And he went to a far country, definitely away from conscious living, because conscious living was the father's home. He left the father's home, went to a far country, living consciously, you could say living unconsciously. And then he engaged in riotous living, straying even further from that conscious living, the values and the love that was there in the father's home. One last thing. The father seemed to be looking for that son and saw him afar off. No judgment, not a shred of it, but welcoming and love back to the Father's home, that place of living consciously. Living consciously is the place where we know ourselves as who we are. We love ourselves, and when it's not true of us that we are loving ourselves, maybe we're a little bit on the other side of things in the unconscious living. Because the truth is that as expressions of the design, we are all that we could ever hope to be. We have all that we could ever hope to have. It's available to us. So the reason we don't experience that is that we have obstacles that come up to us. Obstacles that have led us to question our values, maybe to languish in... Thank you, Terry. Languish in a lack of self-esteem, just not to know the truth of ourselves. Some of those obstacles might be, and we might have different ones that are on this list, let me give you a few. The action of our peers. Peers can be really cruel. I had a couple of those when I was in grade school. And their taunts and their accusations led me to question myself. And then there was the authority figures in my life, my mother and my father primarily. They also made me question my value. You'll never get it right. You might have had something like that going on. Son, you just have to knuckle down and work hard. You're worthless. Well, as a child, I took those to heart. And that diminished my sense of value. That gave me, made me remove from what I was given coming into this earth and on this scene. The truth of being one with the divine, having all the resources, being valued inestimably high. One of those obstacles might have been that you weren't taught to love yourself. Maybe you had those parents that didn't teach that. Or maybe you didn't have a grandmother or an aunt or an uncle that really taught you self-love. Or you might have had some deficiency in your life or some situation or some trauma that kept you from knowing self-love. So those are the obstacles, but the opportunities that go with them, let's go right to that. Let's not stick around in the obstacles too long, because the obstacles are opportunities. The action of our peers gave us the opportunity to rediscover who we really are. Now, most of us did that as children, maybe. I didn't. But as adults, at whatever point we are chronologically or on our journey, we have the opportunity to rediscover who we are. What an opportunity. If we had authority figures that didn't serve us well, we are creatures of choice. We get to choose who those mentors will be for us, who those are that will lead the way. And it could have been that uncle or aunt, and maybe you had that, but it could be someone in your life that gives you some sense of spiritual direction, some sense of spiritual worth and understanding. You get to choose. The opportunity is to choose your mentor. You weren't taught to love yourself. No excuses about that. It's never too late. There are endless opportunities to learn if you intend to find them. Great opportunity. And then finally, trauma, and I'm going to speak about trauma. I'm coming down and talking to you about this. It really was helpful. We're talking about beyond or above PTSD, words we didn't even know when I was a child, or an acronym. So that trauma that affects us today, that triggers us and lives itself out in our life, if we allow it to. There are ways that the opportunity in this is to choose that centering. But going back into psychological terms, how about grounding, taking the opportunity to ground? And I'm going to give you just a couple of ways that we can do that. I'm going to parallel it with that centeredness that we talked about. When that trauma comes up, you're in the fight, flight, freeze mode. But you can choose to ground. You can do what we just did when we were in our meditation. You can breathe deeply all the way from your body. What that'll do, as well as the other tools, will be that sympathetic nervous system that hooks up with that trauma that just keeps it going and going can be bypassed with that grounding. 2 minutes, even, of grounding, breathing, or perhaps in unity, affirmations. Taking 2 minutes to spend time with the affirmation that really is pulling to you. Or 2 minutes to recite slogans that you may have learned in a 12-step program. Just taking yourself out of that sympathetic nervous response by choosing to ground or center yourself. The obstacles can be opportunities. So what about self-acceptance, critical to self-love? We'll look at the prodigal son again, who came to terms with the situation. Here I am, for whatever reason, not making excuses. I'm speaking to the prodigal son. I like to think this is what he said. Not making excuses for it. I'm here eating the husks that the pigs are eating. I'm cold and hungry. I'm here. Don't know how I'm going to receive, but I'm here. I accept where I am right now, awful though it may be. And then it's also getting an inkling of the truth that you experienced somewhere back at home, remembering who you are. So, can we look to who we are? Those times when we really knew who we are, we really knew that we are a child of God or an expression of the divine, however you choose to term it, remembering who you are. So, acceptance. And finally, withholding judgment of you, of yourself. Judgment can be a killer. And when we can back away from it, have an opportunity to accept and to love ourselves again. If the judgment keeps going, there's little chance we'll do that. So how do you do that? Deepak Chopra said, well, get up in the morning and say, I'm not going to judge anything today. Well, that's nice words. I find I did judge things anyway. But it was helpful to start with that intention not to judge, and then to move on to catch myself when I found myself judging. That's how you do it. Intending. Catch yourself. Change your course. Self-acceptance. Very important part of self-love. We bring ourselves to loving who we are. The negative feelings that we have, the unmet needs that we have, the positive feelings that we don't recognize or don't claim. How many of you were taught to not feel good about yourself over the months of years? Felt great that you really had accomplished something. I don't want to be prideful now. Oops, sorry about that. I don't want to be prideful. I certainly don't want to claim it too loudly. Somebody will think that. I'm not saying, I did it! I'm proud of myself. I'm pretty special. I did it. But loving yourself might encourage you to engage in some of that. Love the deficiencies in your life. Sometimes we look at the small picture and we only see that little hard and fast event or situation that's in our life. And we don't know that there's a, we don't remember that there's a bigger picture than that. And the bigger picture, and seeing clearly, is going to allow us to know that all is well. That we're not abandoned. That our destiny is greater than our current situation. Remember that. And then whatever traumas you may have experienced, don't let them rule your mind. Love yourself. Take that time that we spoke about. Take that 2 minutes to ground and center and remember who you are. You, in fact, are the perfect you. One last thing. How about self-compassion? The paraphrase of a quote that comes from psychology, kind of mixed up with Buddhism a little bit. Self-compassion involves treating yourself with kindness, concern, and support when faced with difficult life struggles or confronting personal mistakes, doubts, or fears. Self-compassion responds with kindness rather than harsh self-judgment, recognizing that all of us are engaged in a shared human experience. There are three aspects to go through just briefly of self-compassion. It's very Buddhist. Mindfulness. If you, I have this little book in my pocket with all sorts of things on it. If when we get done with these three aspects of self-compassion and a few words that I've put together to go with them, if you want them, sign my book, put your name in my book, and I will email it to you. It'll happen. Mindfulness. Here's what mindfulness is. Having an open, curious, non-judging attitude and not identifying with negative stories about yourself. Two, self-kindness. Treating yourself kindly rather than harshly. Extending the same care and support to yourself that you would to a good friend or loved one. And three, common humanity. Allowing yourself to be human, to make mistakes and learn from them, knowing that as humans we are not perfect, nor should we be expected to act flawlessly. Three aspects of self-love, and I encourage you to carry on and investigate those and how they may be brought to play. Let me close with, remember this, what's the greatest commandment, they asked Jesus, and of course the answer was, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. But the second commandment is like it, love your neighbor, and I want to emphasize these last 2 words, as yourself. It's like that commandment, the prerequisite is to love yourself. If you would move forward in life, if you would step up in consciousness, open to self-love. First of all, it's a prerequisite to real authentic love. And secondly, you may find that as you grow in self-love, loving others may be so much easier. Love